this time. He turned out a remarkable number of important monographs. His books include The Great Revival, Religion in Antebellum Kentucky, Black Southerners, going down memory lane here very slowly, sorry, and Masters and Slaves, The South Through Time, A History of American Religion, as well as a string of textbooks, institutional histories, lectures, and other publications. In addition, John's most recent book, Jefferson, Architect of American Liberty, has garnered a wide audience and deserved praise. Jonathan Yardley wrote in the Washington Post, "This biography is the culmination of a long, distinguished career. I admire it so passionately that almost 2.5 years into retirement, I had no choice except to violate my pledge never again to write another book review." He goes on to explain, "Jefferson, Architect of American Liberty, is perhaps the finest one-volume biography of an American president." And during this time, when John was working on his Distinguished Jefferson Project, he was also continuing this quiet, effective work of shaping a generation of Southern historians. He has supervised nearly 60 doctoral candidates during his years at Rice. And a few of them wanted to pay tribute to him tonight. So I thought I would plagiarize some of their praise in my introduction. So we have, "Congrats, John, on this honor. No one has been more dedicated to the SHA than you. John Bowles is the reason I am still studying history, and I think so analytically about the world, and the reason that I appreciate beauty in prose, the work of the profession, reviewing books, selecting awards, organizing conferences, writing quality letters of recommendation and evaluation, is a shared responsibility and an important one. It is often poorly distributed and with a possibility for misuse, of course, but that does not absolve us from participation and leadership and, where possible, reform. I credit John with teaching me by example that I should give a damn." I didn't edit all of these when I asked for my Charles Israel. Next we have, "Thank you, John, for all you do and for helping me achieve my dream of becoming a scholar. I will use lessons and, best of all, anecdotes learned from you for the rest of my life. I hope to one day show you one of those monstrous elk-sized deer from Washington that I'm always on about." Next we have the Waymarns, and then I ask people for pictures. "John Bowles models the finest traits of our profession. I look forward to a lifetime challenge of living up to his example of rigor, elegance, and empathy. To readers, he's an engaging narrator. To scholars, an incisive editor. To students, truly a beloved teacher." Oh, sorry. Sorry, Andrew, we're going on to Lynn. I wish I had a photo with John. All those times he had us grad students over to his house, my playing horse with his son sitting on his lawn chair, all that predated Facebook. John Bowles was the most conscientious advisor I could have wished for. He remains my model of what a good graduate mentor should be to this day. I'm truly grateful to have John as an advisor and mentor. His dedication to and support of his students is incomparable. And this for $400. Okay. Complexify is the best advice. Although it isn't a word. He taught me that there's nothing simple about the past. History boggles the mind, another bowlism. But we keep the faith and care for one, for our craft and each other as if it were a religion. Wonderful picture. To this day, if John is near his email anywhere in the world, and I can't contacted him during the morning, I would very likely hear from him by the end of the day.
That's true.
Thank you, John, for making all of our other students miserable. Everyone knows about John Bowles as a scholar, editor, and mentor, but his students know him just as well for the community he built from the ground up at Rice, which was more than merely professional and gave many of us lifelong friends. A mentor, a guide, a friend in every sense of the word. He's the heart for his students, and I'm proud to be a small part of his legacy. When I first told Dr. Bowles I was gay, he replied, "That's great. Now what are we going to do about the people?" Our friendship. Thank you for opening doors for diverse new generations of scholars. We are your legacy. And Andrew Lang of Mississippi, one cannot ask for a better mentor than John B. Bowles' unceasing dedication, and his perceptive, expansive mind will forever amaze me. John's infectious enthusiasm for history, his respect to the profession, his commitment to his students and family, which are sometimes inseparable, are characteristics that we all should emulate. And indeed, there is John recruiting president of the SHA. Without further ado, I welcome him to give his address on My Life with the Journal.
Thanks so much, Catherine. When I actually first met Catherine, my hair was as red as hers. Thanks so much for coming out. Good great year. I'm going to talk about my life with the journal, but I just as well talk about my life of graduate student, because that's been in some sense the center of my academic life, and I always felt the grad students were my colleagues. Faculty were around, but I mean, the people that I most interested in were my graduate colleagues. Autobiographical reflections now seem acceptable for a presidential address. So I will, with your forbearance, use that format to discuss the history of the Journal of Southern History. Listeners hoping for dramatic developments will be disappointed. Other than almost dying in a chicken stampede when I was 8 years old, my life has held few adventures, but many moments of joy and enthusiasm. Many of those involved my years at Rice University and my 30-year editorship of the Journal, as I will henceforth refer to it. I want to talk about how this prestigious journal, scholarly publication, has changed over time, and by the way, say something about the profession and how it has changed, how the field of Southern history has changed. I was born in 1943 in Houston, where my father worked in the World War II shipyards. And my parents lived with others from their hometown in the crowded quarters of an adopted apartment house. After the war, my parents returned to the town of Center in Deep East, Texas, where we lived on a small farm, and my father had a succession of jobs, from driving one of the two taxis in the town to working in a plywood plant, to finally working for a company that installed equipment in chicken houses. Our farm had a few animals, grew for a while, cotton and corn, but for most of the time, our major concern was growing chickens, so-called broilers, and we raised many thousands of them. When I was older in high school, my twin brother and I worked in summers in a chicken processing plant. I remember pasting labels that read, "Grown and packed in Colorado," on boxes of processed Texas chickens, then loaded on the refrigerated truck headed for California. I suppose the idea of chickens having drunk pure Rocky Mountain glacier water just seemed tastier than West Coast gourmets. Working in the chicken plant didn't squelch my love of fried chicken, but it did convince me that I wanted to go to college. My parents knew little about colleges, but there were wartime residents in Houston. During that time, they had learned about the Rice Institute, which at that time offered its education free to students who could get in. Several teachers of mine at Center High School urged me to apply. Naively, I only applied to Rice. Luckily, the school admitted me. I was thrilled, not only to get a free college education, but to spend the next 4 years in Houston. Each year, from about the sixth grade on, my twin brother and I had spent a week with an aunt and uncle and their daughter in Houston. And the city seemed to me, in comparison to our rural farm, a veritable Paris and London, New York City, rolled into one. I loved coming to Houston every summer. That love affair never faded. My initial history teacher at Rice, William H. Manners, was the editor of the Journal of Southern History, which came to Rice in 1959. I later took a seminar on the American West, taught by Andrew Forrest Muir, who was the associate editor of the journal. My tutorial professor for a Western Civilization course proved to be W.W. Abbott, later editor of the journal, and still later of the William Mary Corley. Then in the fall semester of my senior year, I took a course on Jeffersonian and Jacksonian democracy taught by Sanford W. Higginbotham, who in the fall of 1965 became editor of the journal. His course persuaded me to go to graduate school at the University of Virginia to study Thomas Jefferson. But there I got sidetracked, wrote on Southern religion, which eventually led me to write a book on slavery, and eventually a textbook, and so on. More important, I met my future wife there. We happened to sit side by side in the first class on the first day. I asked her to go to lunch, and as the saying goes, the rest is history. UVA was all male except a handful of women in the graduate school, so I knew you had to act quick. 4 years later, Nancy with an MA in history and experience as a rare book curator of all of my library, and me with a PhD, moved to Baltimore, where I taught at Towson State University, and she became manuscript editor of the Maryland Historical Society. With no plan in mind, within a couple of years, I was serving as book review editor of the Maryland Historical Magazine. And in December 1974, when the magazine's general editor, Southern Divine, I found myself editor of a scholarly historical journal. 3 years later, Higginbotham decided to take a sabbatical, and Rice advertised for a one-year visiting editor. With my heart in my throat, I applied, and on the basis of my recent editing experience, got the position. Nancy and I loved being in Houston and at Rice, and my editorship was an exciting experience. Following year, in the fall of 1978, I moved to a tenured position at Tulane, expecting to be there forever. And we made great friends at Tulane. But to my surprise, Higginbotham announced in 1980 he would be retiring in 83. And Rice advertised his position. Again, I applied, and again was offered the job. So in the summer of 81, Nancy and I and our two small sons moved to Houston. I felt like I'd come full circle. But what was this journal whose editorship I would assume? When had it begun? Where had been its editorial homes? How exactly was it edited? What, in other words, was the history of the journal up to 1983? And how would it change over the next three decades? That is the topic of this talk. On November 2, 1934, 15 men and 3 women met at the Biltmore Hotel in Atlanta during an annual meeting of the Southern Political Faculty Association to form the Southern Historical Association. This small group hammered out the concept of the association and drew up a constitution. Persons who had considered founding such a group previously had worried about the finances of establishing an accompanying journal. But Governor Huey Long of Louisiana had wanted to make his state university in Baton Rouge as good as his football team, and thus had begun showering money on academic programs. An ambitious historian there, Wendell Holmes Stevenson, approached the university president, hoping to obtain about $1,500 to fund the journal, only to be surprised when he was offered $5,000. So at the meeting at the Biltmore, Stevenson provided a way for the new association to publish a journal that he would edit. Initially, even the name was not determined. But at the first meeting of the editorial board, on December 28, 1934, the Journal of Southern History was chosen as the title, and it was clearly decided that the new journal would publish articles, documents, and reviews exclusively on the history of the South. When the first issue of the journal appeared in February 1935, it seemed at first glance to be completely conventional. The editorial board was all men, and the cover featured an engraving of an open cotton ball. But that was not the entire story. One of the 4 article authors in the premier issue was a woman, One of the articles concerned the so-called Negro Seamen Act, and two of the authors were from northern universities. This was intended to be a scholarly journal, and its stated purpose was not to write narrow, defensive Southern history, but to bring new attitudes and subjects to the field. The journal represented the beginning of a new era for Southern historiography. The next 25 years brought change, but not as quickly as many would have hoped. For the second volume, the Cotton Bowl was dropped from the cover, only to be replaced with an image of a white columned Southern mansion. In 1941, Ella Long was the first woman scholar appointed to the Board of Editors. But in the first six volumes, there had been six women authors and only one article on the subject of women. And while eight articles discussed some aspect of Black history, there had been no work by Black authors published in the journal. Not until 1955, and Elsa May Lewis's article, The Political Mind of the Negro, 1865-1900, was there an article published in the journal by a Black historian. The first book review written by a Black scholar appeared in 1940, and another in 1949, although books by Black scholars were regularly reviewed. Two more white women scholars were appointed to the editorial board in the 1940s, Catherine Emma Hanna in 1945, and Nannie Mae Tilley in 1949. The first 15 volumes included one article on women and 17 on subjects focused on African Americans. During the same years, 22 articles had been written on or co-written by women. On the one hand, the profession seemed to accept white women as colleagues and historians, but not accept white history as worthy of academic study. On the other hand, while white historians on the whole did not accept Black scholars as colleagues, and the hotels housing the annual meetings did not accept Black guests, these historians did accept Black history, broadly defined as a legitimate field of historical scholarship. But even this scholarship was essentially deracinated. Black people appeared in the scholarship as aspects of economic or agricultural history, not as subjects in and of themselves. Not until 1943 did an article appear in the journal that really examined the experience of African Americans as human actors. Nevertheless, most scholars at the time regarded the journal as a successful advance in the study of the region. As Yale historian David Potter, who reviewed the first 15 volumes in 1950, summarized, during these years of scholarly progress and political change, virtually all significant work on Southern history has either appeared in or been reflected in the journal. Potter was gratified to note that historians from outside the region were increasingly active in the field, and that though there was still a marked preoccupation with the period of sectional strife, the articles were mostly, quote, not concerned with sections of sectional vindication. Potter made no comment on the absence of women's history, but he did urge scholars to shift their glance toward the 20th century and to, quote, pay more attention to the Negro in the South and to the role of industry in the region. The next decade saw changes for the journal. For one thing, after a relatively peripatetic existence for the first part of the flight, with editorial homes at LSU, Vanderbilt, and University of Kentucky, the journal office moved to the Rice Institute, now University, in 1959 to begin its 25th volume. Perhaps reflecting the national interest in Southern history, the journal in 1951 dropped the plantation logo from its cover, choosing a purely typographical design. Beginning with an effort by C. Van Woodward in 1949 to ensure that John O. Franklin could appear on a panel at that year's annual meeting in Williamsburg, Virginia, over the next 15 years, there were halting efforts to integrate the annual meetings. Perhaps most memorable was the plenary featuring Morehouse College President Benjamin F. Mays, along with William Faulkner, at the 1955 meeting in the storied Peabody Hotel in Memphis. But still for years, Black SAK members could not sleep or take meals in the conference hotels. An increasing number of scholars worked to change the policies of the SHA and thereby challenged historic hotels to change their policies, as well as leaders of the movement to liberalize. Leaders of the movement to liberalize the SHA include included such scholars as Woodward, Franklin, Howard K. Beale, Bell Wiley, Augie Meyer, and Bennett Walt. Many more of their white colleagues were opposed to the way things were, but were temperamentally disinclined toward activism. At last, by the early 1960s, the principles of fairness and inclusivity won, and the civil rights movement and changing laws desegregated the hotel industry. Although the journal was on the cusp of change by 1960, the issues of the 1950s had little reflected the changing emphases. The journal during that period published 18 articles by women, but only two on women's history, continuing the trend from before. However, not only did this decade see the first article by a black scholar, Wanda Elson Lewis, but also the end of the decade saw articles by three more black scholars, Bernice Logan, John Hope Franklin, and Clarence Picot. Altogether, the journal in the 1950s published 15 articles on some aspects of black history, and there was a slight uptick in the number of articles on 20th century history. The association and the journal were moving beyond regional provincialism. By the 25th volume in 1959, the journal in most ways reflected national trends, even perhaps shockingly, in the relative absence of scholarship on African Americans as people rather than as scholars. Few articles in the 1950s made use of new methodologies. Sources and approaches remained traditional, even as topics slowly expanded. Again, this reflected national trends. Nevertheless, the journal had come to rise at an eventful time, and the change of the name from the Rice Institute to Rice University in 1960 suggested that the institution itself had evolved beyond its early technical focus and had in fact become a real university. The editorship of the journal was somewhat unsettled at first, with three different editors in quick succession. But in the fall of 1965, Higginbotham assumed the editorship. Fitting, perhaps, since in the late 1930s, as a graduate student at LSU, he had worked as an editorial assistant on Wendell Stevenson's initial staff of the Infant Journal of Southern History. Higginbotham served as editor for the next 18 years, retiring on June 30, 1983, when I became editor. The early 1960s were an era of change for Rice University. The university sued the state to revise its charter so it could admit black students. And even more so were they transformational for the South. Race relations in the region had seemed practically impervious to change for decades. But with the Brown decision in 54, it was clear that, however gradually, the South would never be the same again. Still, Southern states and universities dragged their feet. An onset of sit-ins and freedom riders, and then the full-blown civil rights movement in the early 1960s brought unprecedented and long-overdue change. There was violence, much white hand-wringing, and substantial black courage. In total, the region and the nation underwent the most significant wave of reform in its history. At last, a genuine new South had emerged. And though much still needed to be done, what was accomplished was remarkable. The Southern Historical Association and its journal reflected these salutary changes and in slight ways promoted them. Indeed, a new era in Southern history was born. During the 1960s, white scholars realized what black scholars had long argued and advocated, that black history was a rich, valuable, and vast field for research. And for more than a generation, the most sophisticated and most exciting work of all of Southern history mined this vein. The journal promoted and published much of this work. Although fewer black scholars were published in Moment of Hope, still the field of Southern history and its practitioners diversified. During the following dozen years, 1960 to 71, the journal published 35 articles on black history, but only four authors overall were black scholars. At the annual meeting in November 1971 in Houston, John Hope Franklin gave his presidential address to the members of the Southern Historical Association. Incidentally, as Franklin later pointed out, the SHA was, quote, the first major historical association in the United States to elect an African American as its president. Sitting in the lobby of the Rice Hotel in Houston that November, my wife and I witnessed the tall, stately Franklin walking into the hotel And at a different time, saw a much smaller white man, George Wallace, walking out. Wallace was making a long fundraising trip to Houston. These two unconnected events in the lobby, Franklin coming in, Wallace walking out, nonetheless seemed emblematic of a new era in Southern history. Franklin's address was published in the February 1952 issue of the Journal, and the publication later that year of books by George Rayrick and John W. Blaxengame heralded a new era in the scholarship on slavery. An outpouring of seminal books in the field of slavery studies over the next decade represented one of the glorious epochs in American historical scholarship. The Journal fully participated in its hardest time of publication. Between 1972 and 1983, the Journal proceeded to publish approximately 60 articles on some aspect of Black history. Though again, the number of Black scholars in the Journal was distressingly low three. Many of these articles discussed topics from the late 19th century to the mid-20th century, and these articles often depicted and analyzed African Americans as persons in their own right. The progress made in advancing Black history was not equated in the field of women's history or in the promotion of scholarship by women historians. Despite the three women named to the Board of Editors in the 1940s, not until LaWanda Cox was appointed in 1972 had another woman served in that role. In 1980 and 82, Andrew R. Scott and Judy Open Faust, respectively, were also named to the board. Given the number of women in the profession, the Journal's record of promoting scholarship on women was shameful. Between 1960 and 1972, when Cox was named to the board, the Journal published 18 articles by women and only four on women's history. Even though we sometimes imagine that Southern women's history burst forth on the scene with Anne Scott's The Southern Lady in 1970, the increase in Southern women's history happened more gradually. For example, between 73 and 83, there were 18 articles of women authors on a range of topics and only nine articles on some aspect of women's history. Still, that doubled the amount of women's history published in the Journal. In the late 1960s and through the 1970s, new forms of mathematical and statistical analysis came to be a feature of many articles, especially those on politics. And readers of the Journal, who might once have been stymied by math, came to be familiar with such terms as mathematical correlation, regression analysis, Gini indices, and Gutmann scalograms. This methodological sophistication brought deeper understanding to many issues, and such examples of quantification history continue to a degree in subsequent decades. But what some might have labeled social science did not necessarily detract from the clarity and stylistic grace we like to think characterizes good historical writing. By the time I became editor of the Journal in July 1983, it had become a much more modern publication. 20th century topics predominated. Civil War topics were playing a smaller role, in part, no doubt, because of the existence of Civil War history, which began publication in 1955. And there remained a shortage of articles in the earlier centuries where the Journal competed with really very poorly, and beginning with 1881, with the Journal of the Early Republic. But there was no shortage of good material to publish. Coming to Rice in the fall of 81, I was eased into the editorship by having a year and a half working with the experienced Higginbotham, universally known as Higgin. His longtime assistant editor, Evelyn Thomas Noble, luckily contended in that role, teaching me much about good writing, correct grammar, and attention to detail. Thankfully, she prepared our annual index. But let me pause here to describe the editing process I inherited from Higgin, and which, with advice from colleagues, I slightly tweaked over the decade as advancing technology allowed. When an article came in, it was logged into our manual system for tracking all submissions at every stage, read as quickly as possible, and then either rejected forthwith or sent out to three and often more carefully chosen referees. First in my mind when I read a new article was, does it change how I think about some consequential aspect of Southern history? Would it require me to change part of my classroom lectures, or later to revise a section of my textbook? Not just as an interest, or on something about which I know little or nothing, it had to advance something of consequence. In our note to referees, we suggested as a guideline that, quote, a manuscript should contain critical new information on a significant topic, advance an important new interpretation, or revise a major existing interpretation in a useful manner. We added that a quote must be written in a lucid and accessible style for a broad professional audience. Our final word of advice to referees was that a manuscript should be truly outstanding before it's recommended for publication. We utilized what is known as double-blind refereeing, meaning neither author nor reader knew the difference with each other. While many of the submissions were reviewed by at least one member of the Board of Editors, we ranged far beyond those eight persons in our attempts to choose just the right readers. About half the submissions were rejected without refereeing, usually because they were obviously too brief, had little or no documentation, were lacking in analysis, were too narrowly focused, or had simply had too little new to add to the existing scholarship. All the rejection letters contained reasons for our decision. No one received a form rejection. And many were sent suggestions for improvement that in fact led to publication elsewhere or into resubmission to the journal, some of which were eventually accepted. The other half of initial submissions, those not summarily rejected, provided the difficulties and the opportunities. Even articles that seemed obviously meritorious were sent to referees in an attempt to improve them. No article was ever accepted as is. Refereeing was as much a process of nurturing promising articles as rendering a decision whether to publish, in a way that was a teaching aspect to the editor. We sincerely hope that even the authors of the rejected articles felt that the process was helpful, not hurtful. For that reason, we took great care to choose appropriate referees. I hope to identify those with just the right expertise to help our authors and our decision making. It's gratifying to acknowledge how much effort many referees took to assist the authors in improving their articles as much as possible. Often reports were many pages in length, filled with extremely helpful suggestions. When the reports on the article were all received, I would reread the article in the light of the reports. Usually the articles were rejected at this stage, but the reader's reports included with the rejection notice. But very few submissions were accepted promptly after the reports came in, although all required some revision before official acceptance. For most submissions, however, the authors were sent what we considered a soft rejection letter that strongly urged the author to revise and revise the reports and resubmit. Once this was done, the articles were often accepted. If the reports had been strongly divergent, I tried to provide guidance. I suggested which ones, or portions of them, I thought the authors should pay most attention to. While no one who received a rejection letter felt it was truly justified.